Endland by Tim Etchells. Kings, lords, liars, goal hangers, killers, psychics, and prostitutes. Whether or not these stories bear any relation to life as it is actual lived in Endland, sick, is not my problem, and good riddance to all of those what prefer to read about truly good, lucky, and nice people. You won't like this crap at all. Bear in mind, it is not a book for idiots or time wasters, but many of them are wrote about in it. But let no one deny that it is a good laugh to hear about all the various kinds of mischief, curfews, wickedness, pixelation, indolence, rent fraud, roadblocks, and general FC UKing hoopla that went on in that place, back when Xmas really meant something. For the rest, concerning the bad language, bad luck, and low habits of the persons described, or about any dubious morals that remain implied or alleged in these tales, I make no apologies, and like the poets say, welcome to Endland. All dates are approximate. They replaced the lens in one eye, and I am waiting for them to do an operation on the other. Everything is fine. I am not an invalid. Pax Americana. Death to unbelievers.
About Lisa. A small bad story in 12 good parts. The boss at Dave's topless chip shop is called Harry Stannington. The shop is just a franchise, and the real Dave is more of a marketing proposition than a proper person. Harry Stannington is a pathetic, lying police informant who's going to get his head kicked in and his tongue cut out, at least if you believe the graffiti what someone has sprayed up outside the shop. Harry fancies a new girl that works in the chip shop who is called Lisa. Harry keeps asking her out, but for at least a month she says no. Lisa is basically an unlucky misery guts with a hidden gift for brilliant ideas. Putting her pullover back on after work one day, she finally caves in and agrees to go out with H. Stannington. Lisa and H. Stannington go to the pictures. They have to walk through something like a forest to get there, only there seem to be cats stuck up in all the trees, yowling madly and meowing to get down. When they get to the pictures, Harry doesn't like the film, but pretends that he does. Lisa also doesn't like it, but can't be bothered to pretend. It's one of those films where the plot is just a flimsy excuse put together to justify a procession of different sentimental conversations at hospital bedsides, on dusky beaches, in empty offices, and at tearful breakfast tables. That night, while they're out at the pictures, Lisa's sister gets murdered, and Lisa blames herself. If she hadn't gone out, it never would have happened, etc. Each day for a week, Lisa has to wear her dead sister's anorak and other clothes to reconstruct her last journey. Lisa gets to be on television. She likes acting and wonders about making a career out of it. The people from the TV station have her typecast as the dead girl's sister, though, and they won't give her any other parts. Time passes, and the relationship with Harry comes to a natural end, and he sacks Lisa from the chip shop. There are no leads in the murder investigation, except perhaps Mike Foreman, whose arm is as thick as a porn star's penis, at least if you believe what the girls say, and who was occasionally having it off with Lisa's sister. Mike hangs around in the Bull and Patriot pub. Everyone knows he's guilty, but there's no evidence. Lisa has a dream where she wins the Eurovision Song Contest, singing a song in Portuguese. Later on in the dream, she's back with H. Stannington, having sexual intercourse in the chip shop, and he is imploring her, "Speak Rwandan to me, speak Rwandan. I like it when you speak Rwandan." These kind of crazy dreams drive Lisa crazy. One day, Lisa sees Mike Foreman going down a side alley, and knowing that the law is an arsehole and that Foreman is a murderer, she kills him dead with no regret. The gods, such as they are pretty angry about this, and Zeus, Tesco, Venus, Mr. Stretchy, Penelope, Carly, and all the rest are all having a big row and making various wagers about what will happen next. The ways of the gods are mysterious, though. Lisa isn't struck by lightning or by a satellite falling out of the sky. Instead, her whole life just starts to go bad. To start with, she has panic attacks and many, many long nights of sleeplessness. Her room is burgled twice times, flooded also twice times, and burnt a bit in a fire that is something to do with a bad, persistent electrical fault. Later, probably July, the automatic doors in all the buildings in the city seem to ignore her, and no longer open anymore, like they know she is no longer human, or worse perhaps, no longer a living thing of any kind. Only by waiting for a stray dog to trigger the infrared can Lisa get in anywhere. Lisa gets more bad luck. She gets a skin complaint and falls out with her mum. Her new job at the Institute for Physical Research doesn't last. Before long, Lisa notices that even her image on the CCTV screens in town is getting hard to see, and she knows she's disappearing, and she understands quickly that this is the punishment the gods have meted out for her vengeance of her poor, innocent sister. People in the street try to talk to Lisa and act like everything is okay, but machines and most animals ignore her. In the end, Lisa changes her name by deed poll. She calls herself something more suited to her age, race, sex, and occupation. She calls herself Silence. And from that moment on, she lives up to her name.
Killing of Frank. A Good Bad Life in 11 Short Parts. Frank lived in some northern town which is called only by the title Self-Pity Capital of Europe. What pissed Frank off was that someone kept throwing stone tablets down the well behind his council house. Them tablets were inscribed with all kind of foul curses, and being as how the well was deep, they ended up right near the underworld where God or the gods might surely act upon them, or at least if you believed in that kind of thing. Poor Frank. He was up at all hours of the day and night trying to fish the tablets out of the well, and his breakfast table was nothing but a big mess of breakfast cereal packets, and stone tablets drying in electrical light. "Murderous fucking poison to Frank," said the tablets. "Pax Americana, negative strippogram for anyone what lives here." Frank's neighbour was an American delegate to the recent peace talks, staying at Mrs. Pottinger's bed and breakfast and dealing crack cocaine as a sideline. Frank kept offering the bloke money to see if he would help catch the scum what was throwing curses in his well, but the Yankee was a filthy, reluctant coward. Each night you could see him, counting his money and watching that rubbish movie, Streets of Yesterday, on TV. Month after month, the peace talks dragged on, and it really seemed like Cromwell, King Arthur, and the Reading chapter of the Hell's Angels would never make a truce with the government or anyone else they were fighting. Stuck in town, for no reason, Jake, the bloke from the US delegation, slowly made a friend of Frank and the other local persons in the pub. Over many pints of local lager beer, Jay kept saying how he wanted to go home, and how he just wished the war would end. So far as he was concerned, in fact, just because there were a few kids still throwing stones at the tanks in Toxteth, it really didn't constitute a war anymore. Not by his definition. Jay's room at Mrs. Pottinger's was full of books of philosophy, law, war and killing, so if anyone should have known about wars, etc., it was probably him. Anyway, one night Frank persuaded Jay to sit with him and watch the well, and they talked and listened to the radio a bit. Frank had purchased one of those guns which people had in movies, a gun that could fire any number of bullets you wanted until the final moment of tension when it would run out. He kept the gun inside his Adidas bag, which still bore the names of teen groups he had scrawled and loved during puberty. "Baby Bird," it said. "Goat Trailer. Poison James." Sat by the well, in cool November breeze and waiting, Jay talked a lot of shit, like how he was a difficult person to befriend and he was always moving on from one war to another, etc., and blah, blah. Jay's hair smelt of ambulances in the moonlight. He talked about death, taxes and the devil, and how he'd once seen Arthur Scargill's blue movie cameo. Each night, when he slept, at least if you believe Jay, he dreamt that someone was trying to barcode scan his eyes. This kind of talk made Frank feel stupid. Round midnight, the well vandal came, a mysterious figure who looked from a distance like an old Hindu woman in full veil, but who turned out to be a gangly white teenager in a snorkel parka. The kid was called Poorly Appointment Health Insurance Chasma, and Frank took a shot at him as he walked towards the well. Frank shot and he kept shooting, but the kid, Chasma, kept coming like the bullets couldn't stop him, i.e. drugs. Jay panicked and ran for cover in a nearby house. Time is always and only Timex. As Chasma got closer, Frank kept shooting, wow, like maybe 36 shots from a pistol, until just then, of course, his gun ran out and the kid still wasn't dead. Chasma got right up to Frank and then sunk a knife in him, going right through his check shirt and his lucky nude woman playing cards right into his heart. With Frank dead on the paving slabs, Chasma walked off and dropped his last cursed tablet into the well. "Beetles reform in your garden," it said. "Piss on the flag." At home that night, Chasma watched TV. Atom bombs had dropped on some cities, but the news was confusing. Rank Xerox had bought up all the legal rights to the words Ground Zero. And now, whenever anyone said them, they had to say Ground Xerox instead, or face prosecution, persecution, and jail. Ground Xerox for the explosion was at such and such a time and such a place, the newsreaders kept saying. Now here's a report from Martin Bannum at Ground Xerox, etc. Chasma poured himself a beer and sneered. People made money out of anything these days. Across town, some cops were lounging around, shooting their guns at an old canister of pop crash. These cops were in a cushy squad whose job it was to turn up late, just after all the action was over, sirens blaring and screeching brakes. If they did well on this squad, they sometimes got transferred to another squad where they didn't even have to turn up at all. Only turned the sirens on in the distance to let people know they were around. These cops were arseholes. Round 1 a.m, they got a call about the stabbing of Frank. The lead cop jumped in his car and they all roared off. Frank was long dead when they arrived, and their sirens were blaring. Who would dream that truth was lies? A true story of Earth and the gods. When the goddess Helen and the god Apollo 12 gave birth to sons, it was the talk of heaven, and the naming day for the twins, Porridge and Spatula, was a party that most would not easily forget and some would not easily remember. Wine poured out of the wine boxes like it had no end point, and everyone laughed out loud and wore those necklaces filled with luminous yellow fluid that men sell on bonfire night. Towards the end of the day, when the babes were asleep and all the older gods dozy with medicine, the younger gods like Herpes and Vesuvius were fighting and dancing. The young goddess, Anastasia, and a few others had opened their illuminous bracelets and were flicking the fluid down through the sky onto Earth like a bright yellow rain. All over the world, people were looking up and looking around. They knew that something wild must be happening in heaven. Now, upon the Earth at this time, there was living a very pretty girl called Naomi, and as Porridge and Spatula grew up, they both fell in love with her and made no secret of it, visiting Earth and telling her so, sending flowers and fancy chocolates, etc. In all aspects, Porridge and Spatula were inseparable and friends, and together they loved to go joyriding, flying stunt kites, and to funerals. But as time trickled on, their rivalry over love of Naomi grew too great, and they fell out. The one calling the other a complete lying cunt, and the other vowing never to speak to that dickhead again. Of course, other gods, Scalectrix, Fudgepacker, Chandelier, and Rentboy, all tried to reason with the twins, saying it was not godly to fall out over a woman thus, and to get things in proportion, all to no avail. Only when Porridge and Spatula had a big fight in a Yates's wine lodge, causing hundreds of pounds worth of damage, did their mother, Helen, intervene. At her suggestion, the twins agreed to stage a contest, and that the winner of their contest would be free to woo Naomi, while the loser of it would have to fuck right off out of the way and keep his bloody oar out. The principle of this she agreed with the boys and left it to them to sort out what the exacting nature of their contest should really be. In this detail did the troubles truly begin. In Endland, sick at this time, there was a dire and miserable game show called Quizula that by law was forced to be played on TV each Sat night at 7:30 till midnight on every channel and repeated on Tuesdays. Everyone reckoned that to win on this piece-of-shit programme was better than being king, or being in Mensa, or being like Albert Schweitzer. Quizula, went the catchphrase. You betcha, went the audience. And the whole thing was a degrading spectacle, whereby knowledge itself was rendered to be mere information, and every human capacity and imagination were redrawn as stunted and thwarted lies. Anyway, Porridge and Spatula decided to solve their contest over Naomi by going onto Quizula and playing to the death. When word of this reached Helen and others of the older crowd of gods, they were dismayed, for of course it was against the rules of the immortals to compete in a human game show. Apollo 12 summoned the warring twins to his side and told them off, asking them to abandon the dispute, but both men refused. Come the day, Spatula and Porridge both had a lot to drink in the pre-show VIP lounge and argued a lot, throwing jibes at each other and some other celebs. On screen and sat behind tawdry podiums, the regular captains, Fred and Rosie West, introduced their guests or teammates, Porridge and a pale girl called Leah Betts on Fred's team, and Spatula, playing for Rosie, alongside Joe Haldeman, a minor and allegedly corrupt government official from the Nixon era. Spatula and Porridge both looked very much the worse for wear, and from the outset, it certainly seemed they were determined to outdo each other in bringing heaven and godliness into general disrepute with the studio audience. At many of their jokes and lewd comments, Naomi, who'd showed up for the filming specially in a nice frock, had to look away. And of the questions they answered, most of the time, they were wrong. Spatula did not know who had invented invisible barbed wire, or what was the capital city of Spain. Porridge did not know how many letters there are in an alphabet, or even the name of the first black pope. By the interval, all crowd was laughing at them, and Naomi was covered in shame. As the TV played commercials for Baby Sham, brackets fake kids, Porridge and Spatula threw water and then crisps at each other in full view of the audience, and a scuffle emerged. LucasAid, who was king of the gods at this time, took offence at this, and finally decided to intervene, appearing in the studio like a flash of lightning and causing an immense silence, so great you could even hear the spiders spinning their webs. In no uncertain terms, LucasAid banished Porridge and Spatula from heaven forever and told them off for using strong language. The audience clapped, and the host of Quizula, some vermin bloke called Dick Turpin, thanked LucasAid for all his help and inspiration. Never in the whole history of 100 years of crap on TV have we had such troublesome contestants as them two, he said. Banished in the night, slung out the loading bay doors of Shepperton Studios and bumping into a huge skip full of rubbish, Spatula and Porridge wept their first real tears of regret. And the stars and satellites looked down and gave no pity, as was to be expected in those days. Before long of walking through the city at night, Porridge and Spatula were set upon by merciless thieves who stole what little money, clothes and credit cards they had. "Stay your hand, for we are gods," said Porridge, who was starting to sober up a bit, but the robbers couldn't give a fuck if they were aliens from out of space or if they wore their underpants on top of their trousers or anything. "Shut up, fart breath," said the robbers and Avast Landlubbers and Chemical Kosh and many other popular slogans of the day. Shivering, naked, and with only each other to keep warm, people yelled offensive and derogatory statements of the time at them, calling out that Porridge and Spatula looked like a couple of queer bastards going to a bent kind of party and laughing ha 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 at how they were holding hands with each other and sobbing. Anyway, the two gods soon realised they had to put their trouble and all disputes behind them, etc., if they were going to survive in the cold, heartless exile of real Earth. Of how they stole clothes from washing lines to dress themselves in. Of how they begged yen and Polish coins in the subway, and how they slept in a gutter and a car park, little need to be said here. And of how one night later, they curled up inside the big, big letters of a red neon sign to hide and shelter from the thick falling snow. Not much need be said here either, except to note that the sign bore the slogan, Jonestown whiskey, the taste of heaven on earth, which was ironic. Suffice it to say, the porridge and spatula did not die, and they were lucky not to, and that not being dead was their main achievement in all of the 3 months that passed from the date following their terrible appearance on Quizula. Let us now twist this narration to another of its subjects. While the banished gods, spatula and porridge, wandered the earth all stripped of their powers and dressed in humble shell suits, their truest Naomi did not mourn at first their loss. She was a modern girl, after all, and hip to a different kind of beat, so with the gods out of the way, she soon ended up going out with another bloke and took a job in a coffee shop at Woolworths. Months passed, her cleaning tables and her bloke, who was a bit of a loner, coming in at the end of the shift and chatting to her as the male menopausal boss scowled on in disapproval. Naomi didn't mind the cafe. In fact, she quite liked all the sailors or lorry drivers what came in there and told stories of faraway places down the motorway, which is like a freeway in the Endland, only not so free. Anyhow, at a certain point, things began to see change for Naomi, so that, for example, she put on some weight and felt bad about herself and body parts. Also one night, Naomi had a dream about living in America near the border with Mexico. In the dream, she had to cross the border every day, once in the morning and once in the evening. And each time she crossed it, she lost something useful, a light bulb or a razor blade, robbing her of her heritage and her will to survive. This dream upset Naomi no end, and when she woke from it, she decided to dump the loner guy and try to patch things up with porridge and spatula. She looked for news of them in the free papers and made inquiries at some certain nightclubs and amusement halls where they used to hang out, all to no avail. In point of fact, in order to save themselves from regular beatings, the brothers had been forced to adopt of more normal human names and henceforth went about their lives under the alias of Crispin and Gibson. And thus, like the poets say, for all the world it seemed as though porridge and spatula had disappeared. Together, the ex-gods Crispin and Gibson had about as much luck as ex-miners, ex-paras, ex-lovers and ex-cons tend to do, i.e. not fucking much. And in general, the two fell on hard times and fell in with a bad lottery. If anyone asked them who they were and what the fuck they thought they were staring at, they told their cover story of how they were brothers and travellers from an antique land, and how they weren't staring at anything, but only minding their own business on a visitation to Endland in order to purchase up some parts for an oil refinery. Crispin and Gibson did their best to fit in with life in Endland sick, staying at an unheated Salvation Army hostel and drinking sake out of bottles still in the brown paper bags. Of local customs, firewalls in winter, spastic bashing and plays by Harold Pinter, the two of them were meticulous observant and both adopted the habit of smoking a curly pipe. Anyway, all this disguisery did not stop them being beaten and threatened or having their clothes stolen many times, and of course no one would give them a job, because in the words of an Endland racist song, their skins were as black as denationalised coal. Only at Xmas time did anyone show them any niceness, when a few of the other bus drivers invited them round for Christmas dinner and a stripper or two. New Year 96 for the twins was a real fucking downer, to say the least. Moving on from town to town and upon the road again, like Jack Kerouac and wearing only co-op jeans, blah blah. Together in their misery, P and S swore each other a mighty oath / New Year's resolution that if either one of them were killed on Earth, then the other would marry Naomi and look after her forever. how the brothers wept when they said this, and the sad cars thundered by, leaving them to the hard shoulder and rain just by the on-ramp to the M6 at the Toddington Services, Bristol. Of all this, of course, because she wasn't a telepath, Naomi herself was total ignorant. Time passed. Phone calls crisscrossed the world and babies were born, not much of it to do with this story or the lives contained herein. Only Naomi, long since neglected on the whole planet, thought much about the twins. She tried to entertain herself in other ways, by getting addicted to heroin, by going to discos, etc., but none of it really worked. Each night, she sat in her kitchen, drinking instant coffee that she made with hot water out of the tap and trying to complete a 500,000-piece jigsaw depicting a field of blood, mud and barbed wire at the Battle of the Somme, and in which every piece of the jigsaw was shaped like the body of a dead man. Still, she could only think of porridge and spatula, and she couldn't find restful sleep. One night, in her distress, Naomi called on the gods for help, her hands shaking as she picked up the phone and dialed 0898-333-666 Eternity Now, and waiting through the various obscene ads for other services until someone from heaven came on the line. "Love conquers all," said the bloke on the other end of the phone. "The position of the planet show a good portent for scientific research and mass production this month. The stars are hot, hot, hot for your sex life this year," he added, in a thick Lancashire accent and an acting voice what bordered on illiterate. The next day, the goddess Anastasia appeared in a shivering and shimmering vision to Naomi in her room. She helped Naomi a bit with the jigsaw, completing one of the really difficult bits which showed three blokes who'd been eviscerated by a landmine, exchanged diet ideas with her, then got round to the real point of her visit. Laying a map of Endland down on the table, Anastasia pointed to it and told Naomi where the twin gods had been hiding, their names changed and their faces disguised. Naomi traced red roads over blue rivers on the map, her finger joining places with names like Rotherspoon, Cardiff, and Nigeria. That very afternoon, she set off to find her friends, a few possessions packed up in the back of a car. Sweet Anastasia waved her goodbye and good luck. By this time of year, April, Crispin and Gibson were at their luck's end and surviving only by drinking rainwater and eating cardboard. Indeed, Crispin was working in a factory during the Industrial Revolution and safety was not its strong point. The walls of the factory were bedecked with slogans like "Look, but do not touch" and "Waste not, want not." But this latter especially did not seem to apply to the workforce, who were forever being maimed in interesting and barbarous ways in the machinery, which, according to the management, was for knitting the tangles and knots of wire and wool that people sometimes see in their dreams. It took several weeks for Naomi to track the twin gods down, and for a while it seemed like Spatula Crispin and Porridge Gibson were always one step ahead of her. She tried the Bureau of Missing Persons and Tourist Information and then, in desperation, hired a crippled detective whose compromised manhood was a kind of complex state-of-the-nation metaphor bound up with issues of contemporary polymorphous sexuality. Ironside, for it was he, did a good job helping Naomi and only charged her half the price that it said on his business cards, smiling as he gave her the address of that hotel down near the park-and-ride car park where Spatula Crispin and Porridge Gibson were holed up. Naomi went down there early morning, the trees on the avenues all tangled in their branches with old audio tape and polythene bags that hung in tatters. When she got to the hotel, Naomi bribed the bellhop 3 kisses and then made her way up in the goods lift, hoping to be something of a surprise. "Free Ken Livingstone," said the graffiti in the goods lift, "Mr. Boombastic." Who would dream that truth was lies? In the room, only Gibson was there, lying in bed and watching a film called Pig Trouble, Soviet Kino, 1935, while Crispin was out at work in the knitting factory. Apparently, even the actors on television stopped what they were doing in the middle of a scene and stared and started to cry when Naomi walked in and was reunited with Porridge, Gibson, and apparently even the chambermaids in the corridor outside came running and danced and sang, and apparently even real rose petals fell from the ceiling, and apparently luminous yellow stuff rained on the piazza from heavens above. N and Porridge, Gibson were overjoyed. At 6 o'clock, when Spatula Crispin had not yet returned, they were a bit worried and began to speculate a little in hushed tones. At 7, they were very worried, and at 8, they knew for certain that something was wrong. At 9, there came a knock upon the door, but neither Naomi nor Porridge had the guts to answer it. The person, or whatever it was, knocked several times, waited, then knocked again, but still N and P could do nothing except sit immobile there on the bed. They could hear the person get out a pen and paper and start writing something, but still neither of them dare move to find out what was up. Their hearts were in their mouths. Then, after a while, a slip of yellow-type paper came slipping under the door, and footsteps of the person went stumbling away. In a silence, wherein you could hear the beat of a butterfly's wings, Naomi got up and picked up the paper, unfolding it hurriedly, and handed it to Porridge, for she couldn't read. Porridge read it out aloud, and for all its contents his voice box did not falter. The note said, "The person Crispin killed in a accident at Unilever sometime today. Apologies sincerely." And then there was an unreadable signature. Naomi fainted, and Porridge felt a bit weak, as though one half of him had been taken away and would never return, like the cells in his body themselves were rent asunder, and like the poets say, love, love will tear us apart. A month of weird dreams. Rain clouds inside an office building. A glass cat. 2 kids on a kidney machine. A man with dynamite strapped to his chest. In Porridge's dream, recurring, the gods are arguing about the ethics and codes of their behaviour. One group maintains that since no one believes in them anymore, they are not obliged to behave in any particular way, to set standards or act like a motherfucking role model. A second group argue that godhood is an intrinsic quality whose essence must be maintained regardless of changes in the perception or non-perception of them in the outside world. In the dream, Porridge finds himself standing up suddenly to speak and crying out in passion, thus, "But surely, fellow Olympians," he says, "but surely this is just chasing shadows. Surely this is just the old Stones/Beatles or Blur/Oasis argument all over again." The other gods, especially Zeus, look to Porridge like he's out of his mind. He looks back at them, and only after a minute or two does he see the foolishness of what he's said. Each morning, Porridge wakes from this dream, covered in sweat, mouth dry, Naomi clutched to him, tears for dead Spatula in his right wide open eyes. The gods are just. When Apollo 12 saw how much Porridge had suffered and how much he loved Naomi Campbell, he said it was okay for him to be a god again. And they had a big party up in heaven and a wedding, which is what all good stories end with. Anastasia was maid of honour and their old friend Rent Boy was best man. All the gods were there. Asimov, Golgotha, Vineyard, Hologram, Mr. Twinkle and Horseradish, as well as Barbie and Jupiter and many others too. It was a fabulous day, and neither tears nor fighting did mar of it. Only at one point did anyone cry, when Naomi and Porridge slipped away from the main party for a while and went down to that pool in the forest through which you could look down onto Earth. There, through the clouds and smog, they dropped a tear or two down onto the vandalised and unkempt grave of Spatula in Endland, sick. They missed him, of course, but they kept their promises to him and to each other forever and a day. Eve and Mary. A very good story about two girls in 11 probably religious parts. Eve earned money washing blood containers in a hospital, and later she earned money by going around planting trees for the government after riots in 81. Years later than that even, she used to feel a gush of pride that the stunty wasted trees, festooned with audio tape and polythene bag ghosts, were all planted by her hands. Eve could get pride from anything. After a long courtship, Eve got married to the son of a hairdresser. Eve at that time was a blonde strippogram and he was an oily tarzanogram, and people said they were a perfect match. Some nights they stayed in together and practiced their routines, drunk on gin and laughing like hyenas. Other nights they stayed in and assembled biros for peace work. Times were good to them. Eve and her husband, Tarzanogram, bore one kid, a girl, Mary, whose fave toy was a thing called My Little Void. All night she'd stare in it, and all day, if you let her. Mary had what doctors called the faith of no faith, and in many times dead birds, spiders, etc. were healed in her hands, and their old TV worked better when she sat near to it or spoke, and also she was double-jointed in an intriguing way. At pay school, Mary soon got a reputation, and her locker bore a big sign saying, "This is a prohibited place as defined by the 1989 Official Secrets Act." Teachers avoided Mary, and other kids were scared of her but secretly loved her. No one knew what went on in Mary's head. Let us now change the subject. At Mary's pay school, there was also a boy of the species called McGinnis, whose hair was long and eyes roving, etc., etc. McGinnis was so dumb he didn't even know he was alive. One day he got his hair caught in a new piece of experimental woodwork machinery or something, and his head was damn near ripped off its moorings. While McGinnis nearly died, all the teachers and guards were in a panic, and none of them knew what to do except switch on the school alarm bell and the sprinklers too and shout for help. McGinnis was rolling on the floor like a fish in quicklime, blood everywhere. The crowd that gathered was as clueless as it was voyeuristic and desensitized to violence. Mary walked through the crowd, and it seemed, at least to those who were there, as if the crowd parted for her. What next? Mary knelt by McGinnis and took his head in her hands, fitting it back on where the neck was, cradling him against her and singing softly an old rebel song from the Spanish Civil War. McGinnis swooned and drifted and smiled, caught up in the rhythm of her voice, and Mary smiled, a calm smile that most people only experience a few times in their lives. When the doctors finally arrived, McGinnis was already better. When summer came, Eve and Tarzanogram got jobs in another town, and Mary had to stay home in a borstal. It wasn't ideal, but her parents wrote letters every month which said that the place they had gone to was as cold as hell, and ice froze over all the trees, cars and climbing frames in the parks. There were tigers there, and mammoths, and plenty of idiots too, so there was a lot of work for strippograms and tarzanograms. Eve and her husband got rich, slowly but surely, and joined the middle class. Back home, Mary did a few more cures and was soon pursued by journos and various cults. Everyone wanted to press the story of her miracle working into a story of their own devising, but Mary wouldn't let them. When a kid phoned up sick from a phone box, or when an astronaut panicked on the long climb back down from space, when a train crashed and a passenger was caught, when a bingo caller got cancer of the throat, or when one of the lads on her estate got a hangover, Mary was always there to help. People soon called her God's doctor, though Mary herself never believed in anything. The days and years passed getting faster and faster. Mary's life was like one of those gay musical numbers from a big Hollywood production, only it was a kind of low-budget thing, and it wasn't really gay. People said that each cure she effected cost her dear in physical energy, and that sometimes she cried herself to sleep. If any of this was true, though, Mary never let it show. Only the healing of a whole load of burn victims after a big fire at the local B&Q seemed to take it out of her, and then only for a few days. Mary died winter 1640. Her body was examined by the local constabulary who, by reputation at least, was something of an expert in curios and women's anatomy. He found nothing strange. Her house lies empty to this day and is often visited by gullible people from all over the world. No one can explain the strange rain of flower petals which falls there each year, and still less the words which appear as if by magic in the damp of her dark cellar walls. Peace, peace, uneasy peace. Chaikin/Twins. Note, some names in this story have been changed or omitted to protect both the innocent and the litigious. Chaikin bought a couple of girls in Endland. They were identical twins, the daughters of an upper-class family what had landed on hard times. 16, when he bought them, and pretty to die for, with ivory skin and dark eyes, beautiful lips, the girls were also real virgins, and Chaikin was pleased with that. Taken together as a pair, for the father would not sell them as separates, the girls cost him £250,000, which is about 2,500 kroner. Elizabeth and Jane got taken off to his house in Blank, where his wife, Blank, also lived. Chaikin treated the girls real nice for some time while he observed them at rest and at play. After time, and when they were of age, he began to perpetrate his plan upon them, which went like this. He chose one girl and subjected her, morning, noon, evening and night, to every kind of sexual act, perversion, demand and activity to which his mind and body were capable. The girl, Elizabeth, was, in this way, repeatedly sodomized, whipped, prostituted, made to crawl naked on her belly through the house, made to suck the servants' cocks, used as a table for the eating off of food, made to stand for long hours half-dressed and genitals exposed in the window, etc., etc., and all kind of kinky things he had read about in a book or in the twisted recess of his mind. And all this same time the other twin, Jane, was treated like a right royal princess, washed and bathed in diet lilt, and made clean by servants dressed in silk from H&M, etc. Only once a day were the two girls allowed to know anything of each other. Being kept in separate wings of the house, at 6 each evening they were allowed to speak on the phone and tell each other their adventures of the day. For 6 months this continue, the girl Jane cosseted and spoiled, falling to sleep on sweet dreams pillows during massage by one of the many eunuchs in the palace. And at the same time her sister Elizabeth, crying herself to a bitter sleep, with sperm stains, soreness, and bruises of some fresh indignity still aching in her body. What a great laugh this was, thought Chaikin. Round about this time, a bloke called Blank moved into the town where Chaikin held his domicile and opened a video shop. Blank was curious at the various reports he had heard of the bloke who lived on the hill, but had a wife and two apparently beautiful daughters or cousins or something staying at the house. So, Blank, from the video shop, went up the hill to the house and knocked on the door where Chaikin's wife, Blank, opened the door and bade him enter at his own will. Claiming to be a traveller who had somehow lost his way from the ring road and who was trying to get to Blank, Blank, the bloke from the video shop, was given a room in which to stay the night, and his horses were put up in the garage. Falling asleep in his bed, Blank was woken at midnight by a terrible screaming. He crept downstairs and saw the most beautiful woman what ever walked the earth, in his opinion, getting fucked in the mouth by a whole load of lunatics from the local asylum or something, and each one with a member as large as his brain was small, etc., etc. Powerless to intervene, Blank went back to his bed and masturbated frantically before falling into a troubled sleep. Next morning at breakfast, Blank saw the woman again and, taking advantage of a temporary aloneness, asked her if she wished to put end to her horrible mistreatment and escape from the guest house with him that day. Imagine Blank's surprise when Jane, not Elizabeth, replied that she had no desire to leave the castle, and that her treatment there was every bit as fine and good as she might ever have wished it in a whole month of Sundays, and that she was sure any other girl would give her right arm to be treated like she was. Intrigued beyond belief, Blank contrived to stay another day at the castle by saying that his car still wouldn't start. He spent the day with Jane, who, having been ordered by her master, Chaikins, not to mention her sister, did not, and instead passed the time walking Blank, the bloke from the video shop, around the rose garden and making small talk in Latin, French, and Greek, as was the fashion then. By midnight, Blank, the bloke from the video shop, was no closer to working out what the fuck was going on, and he went to bed in a mood of confusion. An hour later, he was woken, as he had been the night before, by the most appalling of shouts and screams, which, on investigation, looked for all the world as though the gorgeous Jane, with whom he had passed the day most refinedly, was being forcibly enjoyed up the arse by a large priest or cardinal, while a few buxom women in neo-Nazi uniforms, blah blah, held her down. Pressing his eye close to the keyhole, Blank was so engrossed in what he saw that a noise behind him failed to register. When Chaikin's wife, Blank, tapped Blank from the video shop on the shoulder, he jumped up at once and quickly made an excuse about looking for a toilet and getting lost. Chaikin's wife, Blank, told him where the bog was and excused herself, lighting her own way down the corridor with a long and unnecessary candle. The bloke from the video shop, Blank, made as if to go to the bog and then returned to his vantage point and watched Jane getting used horribly in several more ways. After an hour, Blank could bear it no longer and, utilising his memory of the house and the gardens, contrived to find a route into the chamber wherein Jane was getting abused in this way. His route took him over rooftops, through windows, into ventilation ducts, and left him, finally, concealed behind an old type of curtain made from psychedelic curtain material called an arras, in the same room as Jane, whose cries of pain were pretty well drowned out by the groans of satisfaction coming from a whole sports team would had arrived as if this entertainment were laid on for them by Chaikin. Only when Jane's torment was finished and she lay tired on the bed did blank, the bloke from the video shop, reveal himself and implore her to speak with him about what was going on. Of course, this Jane, who was really Elizabeth, knew nothing of blank from the video shop, and thought at first that his presence in the room was probably yet another cruel and unusual idea dreamed up by the insane Chaikin. In the end, though, after much talking, everything got cleared up, the bloke from the video shop got a tearful embrace, and together he and Elizabeth hatched an escape plan to rescue her of the horror she had too long endured. Just at that moment, though, the door to the bedchamber opened and Chaikin stood in the doorway with his wife, whose pale face wore a slippy kind of smile. Elizabeth fell on her bed in a dead faint, and the bloke from the video shop, powerless to resist, was carried off to a high dungeon and also incarcerated against his volition. Several days passed, in which the bloke from the video shop was kept imprisoned thus, and it looked like he'd never escape. All he could think of was the indignities, etc., suffered by Elizabeth, and the many hard-ons this gave him, as well as how he wanted to save her and Jane. Only rats and other animals, scurrying in the dirt of his cell, were any company to blank during this time. Down in the town, some of the people began to get a bit worried. The video store had been closed for several days and people were fed up watching the same stuff all the time, plus they were worried about overdue fines and other penalties. Besides all this, blank had not shown up at any of his regular pubs and bars, and he owed several people a drink. Remembering a conversation about the house on the hill, etc., one of blank's pals organised a deputation to visit that place and search for news of blank. Just when he, blank, was going to give up hope of ever getting out, saving the twins, or eating human food again, he looked out the window of his cell and saw a torch-lit procession coming up the road past Tesco's towards the house. It wasn't long before the locals were barging down the doors with a couple of wheelie bins, helping him, Jane, and Elizabeth to safety. How their hearts sang and blood soared to be free. All through the night, 3rd of November, Chaikin and his wife fled, trying to avoid mob justice, but in the end, they were caught, and their bodies were torn asunder and thrown in a river by the Volga. People in Endland, sick, still tell the story of blank from the video shop, and the rescue of Jane and Elizabeth, and how they lived happily forever and a day, and how the shop they ran was a good one, not like Blockbuster, which rented out many, many defective copies of Pinocchio and Chain Gang, and how the gods themselves, especially Zorba, Poseidon Adventure, Risotto and Mr. Bumpy, were jealous of their pleasure, their happiness and their lives. Afterward, Chaikin's experiment on the twins was certainly a cruel one, but in many ways the results were surprising. Some readers have asked for details of how the two girls and blank from the video shop got along, as it were, and which of them was the horniest and most sexually adventurous and demanding of new forms of pleasure, etc., in later life. However, this is a good book, and one that respects privacy, and it is not an intention here to cater to the purient and voyeuristic needs of that class of reader who, lacking wild erotic events in their own life, would wish that they could read of them here. James, Old Days. It was November and cold. James thought he did not really like a night picnic, and in the hurry to get into the car, when the thunder started, he dropped Kangaroo, and no one could find him in the dark. So then, Kangaroo was lost, and James only had Dead Soldier to play with. For the night picnic, Dad had stretched the blanket on the concrete near them old trees and the high-rises with shell holes in them, what looked like a skull. And they all sat, and Harry cried, and Olivia saw that scary ghosts were stealing crisps from them when they looked away. That was when the thunder started. They ate by the light of car headlights and somehow pretended not to notice that Dad was slowly, slowly, slowly losing the plot. In the car journey to home, James said he was frightened. Dad asked him why, and James said, "The dark." And then it was all quiet in the car. And you could hear the rain, and you could hear the moaning sound that Dead Soldier makes sometimes when no one plays with him. And James waited a long time for someone to say something, and he waited, and he waited, and he waited, and no one did. They drove over Scary Mountain. Through the woods and the sound of trees, James asked, "Who can sing a song to unfrighten me?" Dad didn't say nothing, and Olivia was quiet, and Harry was too little to really understand the question, and Mum was long gone, and there was no one else in the car. After the night picnic, things calmed down a bit, approximately 1 month, and in any case, Dad was back at work, in a big white building with long corridors that was always smelling of disinfectant, probably a hospital or morgue, and the kids went back to school. School was more corridors and also concrete and metal detectors, strange rulers and rationing, learning songs and actions to go with them, and Jay made a picture every day. Pictures, planets, a jungle, gunship, a robot on fire, space vehicle, sky. There was a picture of Dad too. A blunt try at painting something tangible of Jay's world, but Dad in the picture was blurred and waterlogged, lacking definition. Dad swamped in the green-blue colour of bad dreams. A week or two passed. Jay and O learned stuff at the school, Harry cried, and Dad bought an illegal patch for Doom that changed the faces on all of the monsters stalking its dark green corridors into his own face. No one mentioned the night picnic. No one mentioned the rain, which really seemed to start on that night and never found time to stop. And no one mentioned the loss of Kangaroo. Dad's patch for Doom was a passport picture for the country of distortion and death, scanned in and replicated 1,000 times so that in the hours and hours of his playing, he killed himself 1,000,000 times, splattering his own blood to 4 corners, playing again and again, Dad all fucked out with lack of sleep, his own face wounded in the mirror of the screen. There were no more night picnics and no more songs. There were no more phone calls from Mum, but there was a spider web of tension in the house where the curtains were always closed, a spider web of tension linking everything wound tight between the furniture and caught into their clothes. One morning, Olivia found Dad crying again at the breakfast table. There was a gun, or something shaped like one, in his hands. She were too scared to tell anyone. Some conversations. A. Do you think he'll make it? Type of stuff. J. Pessimistic. O. Trying hard. Harry just crying. B. On the nature of physical reality. J. Asking O questions. A dream he had one night about a man whose eyes were spinning saucers, like an olden cartoon. Days of school days. In biology, O closed her book, a picture of dissected twins, and walked with Mrs. Blank to the office, not knowing what to expect, but knowing that the world was changed or changing as she walked. Outside the office was the usual children that could be found there, many of them wearing dunce's caps, and Jay, but not wearing one. O coughed, and the dunces sniffed or looked bored or whatsoever they supposed might be the best, and O sat down beside Jay, and the two waited. In the office, Jay asked what it was, and Mrs. Blank said their dad was not feeling well, and flipped out at the factory and hospitalised in tears, and was there maybe someone else who could look after them for a while? Olivia shook her head, Mrs. Blank made a phone call, and then the new days began. New days. Just down the road from the orphanage, there was a tall electricity pylon that was strictly out of bounds, and that cold winter in particular, a huge plastic sheet half turned to tatters had caught in the bottom of the pylon tower. To James, stood at the window of the orphanage, this black polythene tangle, shredded, draped and folded, looked for all the world like a figure, a huge figure dressed in rags just starting out on the arduous task of climbing up into the sky. James was scared of the big plastic giant, but didn't tell no one about it, not even Olivia, not even when the wind blew and rattled that giant man's bones. Jay's motto was, mouth shut. His practice, in them days, was sticking to it. Routine at the orphanage demanded a lot of getting used to, with many lessons and concerts and debates. Boys and girls were kept separate and schooled in different ideas. The boys learned chemistry and French. The girls learned maths and displacement. There was no outward logic to it that anyone could guess, but the rules were immovable. Jay wrote a letter to his dad in condensation on the dormitory window, but the letters ran, turning to bits and pieces like the letters in Hammer, House of Death. The only chance for James and Olivia to be together was by participating in the out-of-normal schooling time dramatic entertainment organised by one of the most fearsome teachers called Gormenghast. G had written a complex drama, a long story about the life of Madame Curie, a person from history who invented something called radiations and later, apparently, died as a result. It was hard for Jay or anyone to understand what the point or message of this story was meant to imply. Girls in hoop skirts represented radium atoms. Boys in black clothes painted white were a chorus of X-rays, and the whole thing was broken up with nervous musical interludes of indeterminate length. After audition, O secured a small part in the play, probably as a wood nymph, and she brought James along too, lending him a pair of her old brown tights to wear and covering their faces completely in that old green-brown makeup like camouflage that was worn by dead soldier. Rehearsals were late at night time in a part of the orphanage called a basement, and each night began with the sombre eating of an extra meal, a thick grey gruel that turned the stomach shuddering. James looked once in his bowl and described it to Olivia, lip quivering with vivid repulsion, like bits of a skeleton buried in mud. Gormenghast left a shadow wheresoever he walked, even in the dark, and was an object of great horror and speculation for many in the school. After blocking rehearsals one night, he stopped Olivia in the corridor and sternly drew her into a darkly lit and sweltering corner. Olivia gulped. Gormenghast asked if she and James might take on the special responsibility of lighting in the big production. He showed her the equipment. The many lanterns, the thick red velvet drapes eaten by moths, the dusty vertiginous metal walkways looking down upon the stage, and soon she was in love. Rehearsals came and went, and O spended many, many hours perched high up, looking down on the action of the stage. J sat beside her, while all the other unfortunate children came and went below like so many ants at the direction of the depressive Gormenghast. "What is the play about?" James, asking Olivia, no sense of it in his head, the architecture too vast. "Oh, it is not about something," she says. "It is something." An answer Jay could not understand. After the last scene ended, he looked at his sister and smiled. Teeth bad, heart good. Oh, kissed him tenderly, and tears came in her eyes. After weeks of absence enforced by the orphanage regime, the time they spent together in rehearsals was valuable and strange, just like when you see a dead friend in a dream and are so glad to meet them again. November. A timetable crammed with extra rehearsals. The winter nights were long and deep, and the wind told stories that no one wanted to hear. Dead Soldier himself lay many nights foxholed in a box under James's dormitory bed, his eyes night vision but nothing to see, hidden and sobbing and neglected, lonelier by day and by night. Even when Jay was around, he was too frightened to remove Dead Soldier, lest some other child should want him badly or steal him away. All night, Dead Soldier was groaning and his body was aching, and James was ignoring the sound. 3 months in the box. 3 months of dark solitary in realistic colours, and like some kids' club experiment in language acquisition, Dead Soldier's moaning slowly turned but surely into words. Listen. Speech. 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 No one there to witness it. Night time. Magic. In a shoebox. What Dead Soldier talked to himself about when he had got language. 1. The dark. 2. How cold he was. 3. His dead bodies. 4. The idea of an enemy. 5. The power of the human spirit in overcoming loneliness. But in time, with no one to talk to, Dead Soldier's language simply faded, receded, from new words to broken words to no words, and simply moaning once again. Full cycle of life lived utterly alone, strangled.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.